Hi there. In this video, I'm really just going to explain exactly what ambient occlusion is and how it applies to Blender. So to begin with, let's have a look at how ambient occlusion impacts a scene. So I've got a basic scene here with a chair, there's a rug down here and a pillow with some detail on it back here and some lights in the scene. So this is the scene rendered with ambient occlusion on, but at a quite low level. So the factor is at 0.5, and when I rendered this, the distance was 1. And that basically means the effect of ambient occlusion was very low. So before I go further, let me just explain what I mean by ambient occlusion. So in this scene, I've got some words at the back and a basic object here, basically a tube with a bit of detail on the surface here, and then a more cubic object here with some detail in the middle. It's possible to turn ambient occlusion on in the 3D viewport, and that actually is very helpful when modeling things, because as you can see, you have to look quite hard to really understand what's going on with the detail here, especially if you're in orthographic view like this, which is the way I normally model, because it takes away some of the distortions of parallax. So if we call up the right-hand menu with N and scroll down to shading, one of the options is to turn on ambient occlusion. So let's just look at these two shapes when I do that. And you can see we've got dark lines appearing here, and you may have noticed if I turn it on and off a few times, we've got some darker shading appearing here and here. Now this is just an approximation of ambient occlusion, but it starts to give you a clue as to what it's all about. You can't really see much going on in here, but essentially ambient occlusion relates to ambient light. So ambient light by definition comes from all over the area. So it's light coming from the sky, it's light bouncing off any floor. It's not as simple as light coming from one direction. And what happens when 3D rendering software calculates ambient occlusion is that it actually imagines it's looking from a point on a surface and looking out around it. And basically, it's looking to see if there's any other objects, as it were, visible. So if you imagine we're a point right now inside that tube, we can only see this much of the outside world. All other light that's reaching us has to have bounced off the insides of this tube before it gets to us, and that's why we can see the tube. And this tube is effectively occluding or hiding some of the light from the ambient surroundings. Now there's a couple of numbers here. Factor is fairly self-explanatory. It's how strong the effect of ambient occlusion is in the scene. And you can just turn it up and down here. I'll show you exactly what that looks like in a moment. But the most important one is distance. And really, the distance is how far out the 3D software looks to find geometry. So if you imagine there might be some trees or some buildings or something in the far distance, and we need to know whether or not we're going to take those into account when we render our scene with an ambient occlusion path. Typically, if things are in the far distance, although they would have an effect, the effect is going to be comparatively small, so you would probably not render things at a very great distance. At the moment, I'm not in any particular measuring system, so this is effectively 15 Blender units, I guess. On the other hand, if you render with a very small ambient occlusion distance, it will only look for light bouncing off objects that are very nearby. So in this case, had it set to a low number, it would see the insides of this cylinder or tube, but it might not see this object over here. So it would ignore that and just take ambient light coming in. So this is about ambient light, remember, not direct light from a light source. Once light's hit an object, of course, some of the light is absorbed. So effectively, it's dimmer. And therefore, any object or parts of an object that occlude the light that reaches a given area causes that light to be a little dimmer. And that's why we get this effect of a kind of shading, if I turn this on and off, in these edges. The other effect is that it would generally tend to make the scene a little brighter when you first turn on ambient occlusion. Now that may or may not be a problem, but that's part of the reason that you can adjust it with this factor here. So if we go to this scene and we look through the camera and I go to preview, and then I'm going to turn off ambient occlusion here. And you may have noticed the scene got a little bit darker. So I'm going to turn it back on and then turn it up to full. So that'll show it a bit more. So there it is with ambient occlusion on, and here it is with it off. And you can see, for example, the shadows in here, much, much darker. And overall, the scene is darker. Turn this on and the scene is brighter. But more importantly, it starts to try to calculate exactly how the ambient light is occluded. Now, the ambient light from this particular scene is really about light bouncing off other objects around this scene. I don't have a particular background light. And ambient occlusion is really just an approximation anyway. So I guess Blender adds some more light into the scene so that it can then take some away to give you the ambient occlusion pass. So we really get a better effect of that when we render it. So remember what I said about this distance. I've rendered this particular scene a couple of times, and I'll bring those up now. So this one in slot 1 was rendered with a distance of 1, so it's a very short distance. So we've got some ambient occlusion, but it's very, very subtle. So only things that are very, very close will impact the amount of ambient light that is occluded for a given area. In slot 2, I rendered it with a distance of 15, but they were both rendered with a factor of 0.5. So if we change to slot 2 now, you may be able to see it became darker in here. And if I zoom in a little bit and switch between slot 1 and slot 2, you can see there's that subtle effect. And it is a subtle effect. Now, it may be that you want to enhance that effect, because obviously you can use this up at factor 1, but you may not want to do that. You may still want a scene that's relatively dark, and yet you want to make the ambient occlusion stronger than it would really be. So not increase the distance, but increase the range from dark to light. So let me just show you something. Under here in the scene render settings, one of the things I've turned on for these renders is AO, which is the ambient occlusion pass. So we'll just re-render this scene. So I'm going to call up the node editor now. We're going to go to the compositing node editor. You may need to click use nodes. Now I've got a couple of extra nodes in here, but they're not doing anything at the moment. All we're showing is the composite render. But we've got an output here, which is the ambient occlusion pass. I'm putting this through a gamma node at 2, so that's going to make it darker. Now if I just take the ambient occlusion out to the image, you can see we've got an image which is just showing the ambient occlusion itself. So you can see where the shadowing from the ambient occlusion affects the scene, but it's still relatively subtle. If I now take the output from that gamma node set to 2 and put that out, you can see it's much more pronounced now. I actually quite like this effect. So if we then take our original image and multiply it with our darkened ambient occlusion layer at 100%, we now get a much more emphasized ambient occlusion layer. And we can now control it here. So you can see I can take it all the way to the left, and we've just got the default ambient occlusion, and bring it to the right, and it starts to darken it. And obviously I can affect how dark the original is over here with the gamma node. So all that is just a gamma node to effectively darken my ambient occlusion, and then a multiplying node to combine my original image and my ambient occlusion. And that just adds quite a bit to the scene, as you can see. So if I go all the way to the left, it's much more flat. The shapes of the objects are less obvious. And then go all the way to the right, and now they're very, very emphasized. And it's a much more dramatic scene. And obviously you need to find what's the right level for you. So I'm making it slightly less dark there, less significant. But it does make the scene look more realistic. One thing to be aware of, when you add ambient occlusion, and especially when you start to increase the distance, that increases the work for the render engine, and therefore it will slow your render. I haven't found it to be too bad at these sorts of distances. This slot I rendered at a distance of 1, so very little ambient occlusion, and it rendered about 1 minute and 5 seconds for this resolution and so on. Slot 2, which I just re-rendered at 15 distance, and that gave me 1 minute and 12 seconds. So it added a noticeable amount, but it's not too bad. But of course, if you were doing an animation, it would be a lot more significant, so you might want to manage that somewhat. Ambient occlusion isn't essential in a scene, but especially if you want to try to highlight the geometry of the scene or give it more realism, ambient occlusion does add that subtle effect, which isn't obvious to the casual observer, but does have an effect on how realistic the scene looks and how easy it is to see the shapes that you've got in the scene. So that was just a quick one. I hope you found that useful, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.